Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
You're listening to House of Cards.
Today, the game is different.
I want to gamble.
Gambling is a very serious business.
Is that clear?
Welcome to House of Cards. Dave Weishaupt with you here, deep from the swamps of Jersey. We got a great show coming up for you. It seems like everyone's been talking about this new book called Gambler, Secrets from a Life at Risk, which chronicles the incredible life of Billy Walters. This guy was an incredible gambler, an amazing businessman, and this brilliant new book is packed with the fascinating stories of Billy's life. Even has a couple of chapters on the system he used to become one of the greatest sports bettors ever. And we are going to talk with the writer who brought this story to life. Armen Keteyian is a multi-Emmy award-winning journalist and did an incredible job in collaboration with Billy Walters to write this book. When we come back, part one of my interview with Armen Keteyian on the book Gambler, Secrets from a Life at Risk. So stick around, we'll be right back with House of Cards. Hey, this is Dave Weishaupt from House of Cards with your House of Cards gaming report for the week of January 1st, 2024. Hard Rock International and the Tejon Indian Tribe broke ground on a new casino project in California. The Hard Rock Hotel and Casino Tejon will be the closest Class 3 casino to Los Angeles and will have 400 hotel rooms, 150,000 square feet of gaming space, 2,500 slots, 48 table games, and video poker. Phase 1 of construction will approximately last 22 months, with Phase 2 being completed in another 20 months. In 2024, not only will Keeneland celebrate the 100th running of the Bluegrass Stakes, it will award a season-record prize pool during their spring meet. Keeneland will award a season-record $8.1 million for 19 stakes during the 2024 spring meet, which will run 16 days from April 5th to the 26th. Opening day of the spring meet will feature the 86th running of the Ashland. And finally, poker players rejoice because the World Series of Poker announced dates for this year's WSOP. The 55th annual WSOP will take place from May 28th through July 17th, and the $10,000 main event will run from July 3rd to the 17th. The tournament will be held at Paris, Las Vegas, and Horseshoe Casinos with a full tournament schedule to be released later in 2024. Poker players start practicing now. Have any news or tips regarding casinos, gaming, or legislation? Send us an email at newsroom at houseofcardsradio.com and follow us on Twitter at HOC Radio. For more than 30 years, SCCG Management has set a standard of excellence unmatched in the global gaming industry. From startups to established companies, SCCG Management and its team of experienced leaders help each of their clients navigate the ever-changing, fast-moving business of gaming in all its forms. Sports betting, iGaming, esports, casino technology, SCCG Management provides a global network to connect its clients with the right strategic partners for growth on a global scale. SCCG also works with entrepreneurs, providing capital and resources to assist in the development of new and innovative products and platforms. Whether you're looking to enter the U.S. market, expand your reach to other parts of the world, or establish your business in the global gaming industry, look to SCCG Management for the guidance you need. SCCGmanagement.com, expert solutions for strategic success.
You're listening to the House of Cards.
Why, you cheap crook, stealing a baby's bank.
It's only a lend-lease. I figured a bet on the 50-to-1 shot and double the baby's money.
Why, you imbecile. Why don't you pick a 100-to-1 shot and triple it?
Oh, okay.
Welcome back to House of Cards. Dave Weishaupt with you. I'm excited to talk to our next guest because he was involved in writing one of the best books that I've read in a long time. The name of the book is Gambler, Secrets from a Life at Risk, which is the story of legendary gambler Billy Walters. And Armen Keteyian did a masterful job of bringing the story of Billy to the public. And we are lucky and thrilled to have multiple Emmy Award-winning journalist Armen Keteyian on the line. Armen, thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, my pleasure, Dave.
First off, congratulations. Absolutely an amazing book. I told the author, I think I read it in like in a day and a half. It was so interesting, I couldn't put it down. If you're a professional sports bettor, or you're a sports book operator, or if you're in the business in sports betting, you've certainly heard the name Billy Walters. I'm curious, as a journalist, when did you first hear the name Billy Walters?
Well, that's a funny story. So in the mid-80s, the specific date would be March of 1986. I was at Sports Illustrated as a writer-reporter. They're pretty much their top investigative reporter. And the magazine did a special section, 32 pages, special report on gambling in America. And one of the stories that was part of that section was the first national story on the computer group. And I did a lot of reporting on the computer group on a story that was written by Robert Boyle. And because I'm a little weird in certain ways with obsessiveness, I still have that file, that computer group file. So Billy's name was not in the story, but Billy's name was all over the reporting in the story because he was moving all the money for the computer group. And when they did all the search warrants relative to the computer group case, the FBI, Billy's name was literally almost on every single search warrant. So when I was approached to do this book in June of 2020, the first thing the person, Glenn Bunting, who represents Bill in strategic communications and PR, he said, "Do you know Billy Walters?" And I'm like, "The computer group, Billy Walters?" Yeah, that's who Billy Walters is. So that was my first, the second iteration of the first time I ran across Bill. And, you know, June of 2020 turned into a couple of months of Bill and I talking. I wrote a couple sample chapters that he really liked. And so we came to an agreement in September of 2020 that, you know, I would collaborate with him on the book. And honestly, Dave, I thought in my head it would take about a year and a half to write the book. Pretty early on, I realized that was an underestimating the scope and the depth of Billy's life. And so what was a one-year project or 18 turned into a three-year project. And honestly, I don't think the way Billy is as far as his obsessiveness with detail and wanting to get things right. I think 3 years was probably the right number.
It's an absolutely fascinating life. Again, the book is called Gambler, Secrets from a Life at Risk, and it chronicles the life of Billy Walters, who really had a pretty difficult upbringing. Basically, the structure in his early life came from his grandmother. Tell us about his upbringing in Kentucky.
Well, it's really, I think, to me, probably the most amazing part of a amazing life. I mean, if you think about Billy's life, it's really three or four or five different lives strung together. The first one, you know, he's born into rural poverty in Mumfordville, Kentucky. His dad dies when he's 18 months old. He doesn't really ever know his father. His mom, who is about 14 years younger than his father, immediately kind of hightails it north to Louisville, leaving three children in the hands of relatives. Billy, by the grace of God, gets left into the hands of his grandmother, who is the most, I would say, seminal influence in Bill's life, certainly when it comes to discipline and respect for others and doing the right thing. By the time he's 7 or 8 years old, he's mowing lawns. He has a paper route. He's shining shoes. And the part that you just can't make up, his Uncle Harry owns a pool hall, the Q&R pool hall in Mumfordville. And Uncle Harry becomes the de facto babysitter when grandmother is working her two jobs that she's working. So by the time Billy's 4 years old, he's in the back corner of the pool room standing on Coke boxes and got a pool cue in his hand. And by the time he's 10 years old, he's known as the kid. He's a pool hustler and a very good nine ball player. But that's just like the beginning of the first part of his life. By the time he's 17, the first girl he ever dates in high school gets pregnant. Billy's a junior in high school when he's married with a child at 17 years old. He barely scrapes through. And then by 19, he's the best used car salesman in the state of Kentucky. At 19 years old, he's making $56,000 a year, which is the equivalent of about $500,000 in today's dollars. But he's burdened through every last dollar of it gambling, staying out, chasing around, not with women, but just with his buddies, gambling on anything that moves. And then just to kind of fill out that first part of his life, by the time he's 23 years old, he's been married twice and he has three kids. So that's generally, in my mind, that's a, you could write a book just about that first part of Billy's life.
Oh, no, it's absolutely incredible.
Yeah. And the fact that he survived that, the first part of the Horatio Alger story, and didn't just become a, you know, a total loser and a degenerate, to me is amazing. And it has so much to do with Bill's fortitude and his discipline, now, not so much then, but his, I think Billy always wanted to be great at something. What that was going to be, I don't think he was very certain about it at certain times of his life, but, you know, I, when I was writing that section, that part of the book, it was just so enjoyable because it's literally like something out of a movie. You know, you're trying to, like, really? This is true? And trust me, I talked to a lot of people beyond Bill. In fact, I think I did 60 different interviews independent of what I, the hundreds of hours I spent talking to Bill, thousands of hours, just to confirm the scenes and the settings and the stories, because some of them you're like, Bill, that can't be true. And then, sure enough, it was true.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more House of Cards.
With costs going up, Adam and Eve is the best deal around. With 50% off a sexy adult product at adamandeve.com. That's 50% off right now. When you point the camera on your smartphone at the code on the screen, don't get up, just open your camera and point it at the screen. Hurry! You'll also get 10 free gifts, including free discreet shipping at checkout. This is your chance to get more for less. So scan now for 50% off plus 10 free gifts from adamandeve.com.
Drizly makes it easy to shop a huge selection of beer, wine, and liquor from wherever I am. I just open the app, find what I want, and it's at my door in under 60 minutes.
Drizly.
Ding dong, Drizly.
You're listening to the House of Cards.
Is that good? Do I want that?
Oh yeah, you want that.
Well, fantastic then.
Welcome back to House of Cards. Dave Weishaupt with you. This portion of House of Cards is brought to you by SCCG Management, delivering technology-driven capability, expertise, and customer and business value to the gaming industry for over 30 years. For more information, go to sccgmanagement.com. For those of you just joining us, I am talking with multi-Emmy award-winning journalist Armen Keteyian about his new book, Gambler: Secrets from a Life at Risk, about the legendary gambler Billy Walters. What was amazing to me is how driven he was. I mean, he was making money in the pool rooms. I think he placed his first sports bet at 9 years old on the Yankees and the Dodgers World Series. But, you know, he was working several jobs to get the money he was betting with. For me, I thought he was a very intelligent person who was just incredible at absorbing information around him. What did you see as the characteristic that made him not only a successful gambler, but also a successful businessman?
Well, I think that's very astute. I think he's absolutely driven. And I think, you know, if you drilled down and said what was behind all that, I think losing your father when you're 18 months old and never really getting to know him at all, I think Bill in his own way was trying to prove to his father that he was a success. Mm-hmm. And that even though his father would never know a single thing about that, when Billy could look at out at when he would stand on his grandmother's porch and look out over to the Mumfordville Cemetery, which was right across the street. And I actually was there when we took a tour of his hometown and Louisville together. I think he was talking to his father in a lot of ways. You know, I'm going to prove to you that I'm better than what other people might think of me. So there's that. And then the other side of the equation is Billy absorbs information, whether it's in sports betting, mm-hmm. or whether it was in the stock market, or whether it was making a business deal. He would never go into a meeting. He would rarely, if ever, make a bet. Early on, he made some major mistakes in the stock world in investing, but now he absorbs information and can process information like a computer. And he's very disciplined, but he's also a zero-sum game kind of a businessman. He is going to have answers to every single question that a potential partner is going to have or a potential acquisition that he wants to make. I mean, you don't own or co-own 22 car dealerships,
sure,
and 13 golf courses in addition to doing the kind of sports gambling that he was doing from the beginning of the college football season through the mm-hmm. probably the Final Four, some years betting year around 365 days a year. But I think you're right, Dave. I think his processing capabilities, but Billy's also, he likes to win,
yeah.
you know, and he's willing to put in the time and the effort and has tremendous discipline now that all, when you add all that up, you I think you have a tremendous advantage in, mm-hmm. in the world of, whether it's in the world of sports betting, stock market investing, or business. And there's not a lot of guesswork with Bill Walters. And trust me, you know, when you spend 3 years with him, I mean, I did the math one day, and I figured I spent north of 7,000 hours
wow.
working on the book. And I can tell you, I had co-written three other autobiographies of Mike Singletary and Catfish Hunter and George Lopez, the actor, comedian. And Bill spent more time on the book than those three men combined. And that's not to say that they were blowing off their part of the equation. It's just to say that Bill was obsessive. And he must have read various versions of the manuscript at least 20 different times. And I know on two occasions and probably more, he went over the manuscript line by line, word by word, at least twice. And I've never, from the co-author perspective, I never had anybody that was that detailed and that concerned about getting everything absolutely right.
One of his big successes came in the late 70s and early 80s in Louisville when he set up shop as a bookmaker. And unfortunately, that got the attention of the officials, and he was indicted because of that activity. Tell us what happened in his time as a bookmaker in Louisville.
Well, it's interesting. You know, Bill had, I think it, for the most part of his teens and into his 20s, he was as big a bettor as there was. Mm-hmm. In Louisville, which is no, as you might imagine, that's not a small pool of people that like to gamble in that town. I mean, Bill would bet on anything, horses. He could be flipping nickels against the bathroom wall for a dollar, you know, $100 a flip. So, he saw opportunity. He saw a lot of the guys that would come Monday morning looking for the envelope from Bill Walters.
Yeah.
In their Cadillacs going, you know, wait a second here. They're getting both sides of the action. I'm on the losing side most of the time. maybe I can do better. Maybe I can give better odds. Maybe I can stay open longer. Maybe I can have better customer service. Maybe if you bet the entire card, it's $1.05 instead of $1.10. And he, at the same time, there was a mayor who was cracking down on all the illegal gambling, and that was one of the pillars of his campaign. And Billy's not in Louisville proper. He's in another county thinking he's safe. Mm-hmm. Well, he's not. The state police and the cops bust in, and Billy gets busted. And he had the good fortune, if there is such good fortune, of hiring the best criminal defense attorney in the certainly in Louisville and probably the state of Kentucky, a guy by the name of Frank Haddad Jr. And Billy by that time had burned out in the car business. He went from selling used cars to going to a bigger lot to becoming an independent wholesaler, where he would go up to the auctions in the neighboring states, primarily Indianapolis, and buy 20 cars at a pop, and was over leveraged and was playing the floating title game. It just wore him out. And so he got out of that and he opened a bar, and then from the bar, there was the betting on the Super Bowl and other things. And the next thing you know, he's a bookmaker. But, Frankie Dad told him, he said, Billy, you got two options here. You can either get out of the bookmaking business or you can get out of town.
Yeah.
And, Billy, this to me is one of the, it's hard to believe. Billy's he's addicted to gambling. He's got an alcohol problem. Well, where's the one place that a person who's got vices?
When I read that, that was the first thing I thought of. I was like, wow.
He goes to Vegas. Uh-huh. But it's the only place, Nevada's obviously the only place in the union that at the time that sports gambling was legal. Mm-hmm. But as we say in the book, that's a place that he eats, addicts for lunch and dreams for dinner. But Billy, to his credit, with Susan, thank God, mm-hmm. His wife now of 47 years, who is a saint, with a capital S, they decide to go to Vegas. And to me, it's like, well, there's another chapter of Billy's life that opens up. And as you well know, Dave, Vegas in the early 80s, a little different than it is today, for sure.
Well, that was my question. I mean, what effect did living and moving to Las Vegas have on him? He certainly met some of the best poker and golf buddies anyone could ever find. So what effect did Vegas have on Billy?
Well, I think it was the biggest thing that ever happened to Billy. Before he left, when he was 32 years old, back in Louisville, I think it was four of his friends got together, and they actually had an over-under on whether Billy would live till he was 35 years old.
Wow.
And it was, I think it was $5,000 a man.
Wow.
And nobody took the over. I mean, everybody took the under. Nobody thought Billy was going to live past his mid-30s. Well, 36, he goes to Vegas, and he had been laying money off for the computer group in Louisville because he had the guy, he was laying off money from his own bookmaking operation in Pittsburgh, mm-hmm. and the Pittsburgh guy was laying off money for the computer group. For those that don't know what the computer group was, your audience I'm sure does, it was the first syndicated sports betting operation that used, computer data and computer algorithms to go up against the book. Mm-hmm. And for about, I would say, a 5 or 6 or 7 year period, they just absolutely crushed the books. They were winning 60% of their, as much as 60% of their games and betting millions every week. So Billy eventually became the biggest layoff guy for the computer group. So when he came to Vegas, the computer group was up and running, started by Michael Kent. And then he became really a pivotal focal point of that operation. But at the same time, I mean, he's carrying around all these addictions with him.
Yeah.
And it takes Bill about 7 or 8 years before he has this pivotal moment, a moment of crisis, where he stops drinking and he stays out of the casinos. And that was another life for Bill. But as you said, Doyle Brunson, Chip Reese, Dewey Tomko, Stewie Unger, Sarge Ferris, Jack Binion. That's just the rounders that he was hanging out with. And at the same time, you know, he's learning how to really be a really good poker player and Texas Hold'em player. But he's also learning from Chip Reese money management. And that was a absolutely pivotal moment in Bill's life, because Chip was the best money manager I think Bill has ever seen, rest his soul. And again, these sort of opportunistic times or moments where Bill gets touched on the shoulder by some higher power, but he's smart enough to learn from it. And his relationship with Chip really, I think, is at the heart of Billy's betting system now.
Mm-hmm.
In so many ways, about when you're talking about, you know, not, you know, discipline is critical. His formula is not to bet, you know, if his bankroll is, I'm just going to throw a number out, 10,000, he never would bet more than 1 to 3% of his bankroll. So he'd never bet more than $300 on a single game. And I think that, as we were working on those chapters, you really understand that discipline is part of Billy's DNA, whether it's in business or investing or certainly in sports betting. But that Vegas world, I mean, for those that have seen the movie Casino,
yeah,
Joe Pesci played a character that was based on Tony Spilotro, who was just a villainous who took great joy in using industrial tools, blowtorches and wrenches and vices and things like that to get his way. And he was a reign of terror in Vegas. You know, at the same time, you got Lefty Rosenthal there, and the town is kind of blowing up, and it's being taken over by organized crime from Chicago, the outfit. And Billy's in the middle of that, in a lot of different ways. So the fact that he survived that period of his life is another one of those hard-to-believe stories.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more House of Cards.
Interest rates and inflation are out of control. Is your credit card debt also out of control? It's time to resolve your debt and take back control for a lot less than what you owe. If you have $10,000 or more in credit card debt, then you need to call us right now. Debt Fix Pros can significantly reduce the amount you owe, and you could be debt-free faster than you think.
I knew we had to do something. Our debt was growing.
It was getting out of control, and we just didn't know what to do.
We saw an ad for Debt Fix Pros. We called, and they showed us how fast they could get us out of debt.
It really was amazing, and now we're back in control.
Call now, and we'll show you how easy it is to fix your debt. The call and consultation are free. Call Debt Fix Pros right now at 800-479-3522. That's 800-479-3522. 800-479-3522.
With costs going up, Adam and Eve is the best deal around. With 50% off a sexy adult product at adamandeve.com. That's 50% off right now when you point the camera on your smartphone at the code on the screen. Don't get up. Just open your camera and point it at the screen. Hurry. You'll also get 10 free gifts, including free discreet shipping at checkout. This is your chance to get more for less. So scan now for 50% off plus 10 free gifts from adamandeve.com.
Every 40 seconds, a kid is reported missing. Find the Children provides educational material that teaches your kids how to recognize and avoid predators. Our recovery programs are very successful in bringing kids back home to their family. You can help protect our kids and bring the missing kids home safe by donating your unwanted car, truck, SUV, or van. Running or not, we guarantee you will receive the maximum tax deduction. We provide fast free pickup, usually within 24 hours. Over 2,000 kids are reported missing every day. Call now to donate your vehicle. Donate now to bring these kids home safe.
Call 800-934-2260. 800-934-2260. 800-934-2260.
You're listening to House of Cards.
Your Majesty, the royal wrestlers await.
I'll bet on the little guy.
How much?
3,000 guineas, 2 geese and a duck.
That's a foul bet.
Welcome back to House of Cards. Dave Weishottle with you. House of Cards is brought to you by the Life Hack Pack from More Labs. Unlock your best self with the Life Hack Pack from More Labs. The Life Hack Pack contains 2 bottles of Morning Recovery, 2 bottles of Dreamwell, and 2 bottles of Liquid Focus. The Life Hack Pack is specially designed to help you live your life not just better, but smarter. Use promo code RADIO15 at morelabs.com to get 15% off your first purchase of the Life Hack Pack or any of their other great products. That's promo code RADIO15 to take advantage of this great promo of 15% off your first purchase at morelabs.com. You can finally do it all with help from More Labs. For those of you just joining us, I am talking with multi-Emmy award-winning journalist Armen Keteyian about his new book, Gambler: Secrets from a Life at Risk, about the legendary gambler Billy Walters. What fascinated me about his move to Vegas was his involvement with the computer group, like you were talking about. I mean, sports bettors nowadays always talk about the algorithms or computer programs they use. And for me, modern sports betting seemed to stem from the computer group and the computer program written by Mike Ken, who actually wrote the computer program because of a softball game, which was absolutely amazing to me. But yeah, because of the computer group, Billy was indicted again because of his involvement with the group. And it's amazing, speaking as a lawyer myself, how wrong the government understood the law in this situation. What was the government's case against Billy, and how did Billy defend himself during this case?
Well, I think it's pretty amazing. I mean, that's a whole another. It is literally a chapter or two in the book.
Yeah, it is.
And I think the government never believed that you could make money betting sports. They always felt that you had to be booking as well to come up with the money that you would use to gamble. And it was an FBI agent who just. Thomas Noble, how's that for a last name?
What an ironic last name.
What an ironic last name. And Thomas Noble didn't know diddle-do about really how sports gambling in America worked. He heard a couple things, saw a couple things, put 2 and 2 together and got 5, and figured that, I've stumbled upon a massive sports betting operation controlled by organized crime. So he didn't understand that they were making bets, not taking bets. And that was really at the heart of the case, is that the government believed that this nationwide sports betting syndicate, not bookmaking syndicate, was making millions of dollars illegally, and they were controlled by organized crime. And they raided all of these people's homes in 1985, it wasn't until 2 weeks before the statute of limitations was going to expire in 1990 that the government indicted all these people. I think at the time it was 18 people, including Billy and Susan Walters, on the belief that they were committing massive crimes. Well, it was about as big a swing and a miss as I think the government has taken in a case in which untold amounts of money was spent and untold amounts of time was spent by FBI agents around the country. When the case finally went to trial in 1992, Billy had some incredibly good lawyers, mm-hmm. and Thomas Noble was completely undressed on the stand.
Yeah.
In terms of what he knew or didn't know about really sports gambling, laying off money, the operation of the group. I think it was a 120 count indictment. 50 something of them were not guilty. 60 something were not guilty. Another 50 something, the government declined after just being crushed by the jury, declined to prosecute. So, but what's interesting about that, Dave, and as you know, having read the book, that put a target on Billy's back.
Yeah.
You know, because he was Michael Kent wasn't indicted because he cooperated with the government and testified and said, hey, we're making bets, not taking bets.
Mm-hmm.
But in the end, you know, Billy became the high profile person in that case.
Yeah.
And from then on, you know, not just federally, but in the state of Nevada with attorney generals and local prosecutors who were trying to make a name for themselves. You know, you take down Billy Walters, that's a big feather in your cap.
Yeah.
And, you know, Billy, time and time again, the man's been indicted 6 times in his life, mm-hmm. and we'll get to the one that really sticks in Billy's craw.
Yeah, yeah.
Reasons that to me are just what the government did in order to set the trap and to publicize the indictment and then take Billy to trial is really, I wouldn't wish that on any American.
No.
So, but you know, the computer group today is still, I mean, you guys are much more into that world. I spent, mm-hmm. You know, enough time in it. And I should give credit where credit is due. And I will. Dave Satterfield, who is another very, very talented writer, was the former business editor of the Miami Herald and the managing editor of the San Jose Mercury News. I wrote the templates for those betting chapters and helped, but Dave was really the guy that was day to day with Billy and working with the brain trust and all the, you know, all the charts and the graphs and things you see in those two chapters are, you know, that was a group effort.
Yeah.
And Dave Satterfield had he had a big hand in it. And 'cause I was up to my ears and the other, you know, 26 chapters.
I got to tell you, what was astounding that I found incredible was how Billy compiled information on what he was betting on during the time when the internet wasn't there for him to use. I mean, he was collecting newspapers left from tourists to gather information on teams from around the country since, again, that was a time before the internet. I mean, information wasn't at your fingertips, and I found that incredibly compelling how he did his magic getting old newspapers. What people thought were garbage, he turned into gold.
That's a great way to put it.
Yeah.
I should have used that line in the
there
book.
You go.
It's, you know, to go out to McCarran and to find the guy that's supervising the cleaning of planes that are coming in all day long from all over the country, and he would have the crews that would come on the planes, they would collect the newspapers, the sports sections, and they would pass them to the people that would go to the airport on behalf of Billy several times a day. But you think about that, the sports sections in those days were loaded with information.
Yeah, yeah.
And stories about the teams and the coaches and the morale and all of that stuff. And you're absolutely right. At a time when, you know, people like Bob Martin and some of, you know, Scotty Shetler, they were making lines, writing things down on a piece of paper. Billy's grabbing all this information, but he's also got people. I mean, at one point in time, he had, I think we wrote 1,600, but I've listened to some interviews that Billy did. He said it was 1,750 different places where he could get a bet down. And, you know, people speaking through voice changers, hiring people in Ireland to bet for him. He went to such extraordinary, incredible extremes to camouflage who was actually behind the bet in that cat and mouse game with the bookmakers. To me, that's another astonishing part of it, just an incredible life. And, mm-hmm. and I think one thing I want to make a point too, if you don't mind, is, you know, kind of the last thing I wanted to do at this point in my life was to write another just pure sports book. Mm-hmm. And I think, as you said, Dave, and I really appreciate those words, is, you know, this is a great book, a fascinating book about a one-of-a-kind life. Yeah. And a man who sees things differently, who acts differently, this rags-to-riches story. It's also, as Billy said, he wrote it to try to inspire other people to look at their lives and say, you know what, if Billy Walters could do that, or if he could rise out of those ashes, maybe I can do something here too. So what I've really liked in the reviews that have been on Amazon and other places is that the book resonates far beyond the world of sports.
Yeah.
Yes, there's his secrets are in there, sports gambling, and yes, there's you know, a lot of funny stories about gambling and golfing for unreal amounts of money. Mm-hmm. But the heartbeat of the book is really a story of a man who's lived this one-of-a-kind life. And in the end, I think a pretty inspiring life, who has done more things for more people quietly and anonymously to help others. We all know people that have more money than they know what to do with, but they're very protective of it or cheap about it. Mm-hmm. Billy has given away millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars from Opportunity Village on down to help other people, little people that otherwise wouldn't have been able to pay for a funeral or to pay for unexpected healthcare expenses and stuff like that. That's what, to me, that's the Billy Walters I really like, and I care deeply about him because he's just that one of a kind of a person when it comes to things like that.
You know, I'm glad you mentioned that. I didn't know how much he has given back through, like you said, Opportunity Village and Hope for Prisoners. I mean, it seems like a side of Billy Walters that no one knows about.
I totally agree with you. I mean, you know, look, there's Billy's not a saint. Mm-hmm. Susan's a saint, as I said. Yeah. Billy, not so much in certain ways. I mean, he can be a cutthroat businessman, and mm-hmm. you know, he's very opinionated, and it's his way or the highway. And you know, there were times, you know, I would literally be banging my head against my right in front of him. I'm like, Bill, we can't put another name in the book. We can't. I don't need the backstory here, Armen. I want to tell you the backstory, mm-hmm. and then, but at the same time, I've seen him do things for people. And I think what really kind of grabbed my heartstrings was I read all the letters that were written to the judge, Judge Castell, before Billy was sentenced on the insider trading case mm-hmm. in New York. It was at least 100 letters. And yes, everybody from, you know, Senator Reid to Peter Jacobson to David Faraday, they all wrote letters. But the ones that really touched me were the ones that were written by employees that had worked for Billy for 20-something years, a bartender at one of his golf courses, or somebody who was a, you know, a sales manager at one of his automobile dealerships. And what Billy had done for them anonymously, quietly, to help get them out of a terrible situation, That's the Billy Walters that I was like, okay, that's the guy that we have to, you have to feel that guy in this book.
Yeah.
And I think that's, you know, to Bill's credit and to the credit of the editor and, you know, the amount of work I put into it, you feel that. And that's the Bill Walters that I hope in the end, when people finish the book, they go, wow, that's a unique individual.
And that was part one of my interview with Armen Keteyian on the book Gambler, Secrets from a Life at Risk, the story of professional gambler Billy Walters. Come back next week for part two. But right now, stay tuned for more House of Cards.
Attention. If you owe back taxes to the IRS, watch this urgent message. The IRS is cracking down by hiring 87,000 new agents to garnish your paycheck and put liens on homes and businesses. They can even seize your bank account. The IRS calls it enforced compliance, and now they have the manpower to get you. Penalties and interest on unpaid taxes compound daily. So call One-Stop Tax Relief Shop and get the IRS off your back. They're experts in the Fresh Start Initiative, one of the biggest breaks the IRS has ever offered. And no other tax shop gets you more or faster approvals. One-Stop Tax Relief has resolved thousands of cases since 2014 and saved clients millions of dollars. Call now for a free consultation. Connect with tax professionals who get the IRS off your back.
Call 800-605-0688. 800-605-0688.
Casino. People gotta win sometime.
Now, if you'll excuse me, I have a giant, colorful check to deposit.
Welcome to another edition of Beating the House. I'm Doug Weishaddle here with Dave Weishaddle. We're going to be crisscrossing the country, the North America, sometimes even the world. As a matter of fact, this week we will be crossing all over the world.
Really?
To discuss some of the latest jackpots in the casino and lottery industries. If it's $100,000 or more, we will be talking about it on this show. Press releases, please keep those coming in. We love hearing from everybody out there. This is the last show of the year for us.
Yeah, a lot of jackpots we talked about.
A lot of jackpots all through the year. Saw a lot of new games introduced.
Yep,
and hope to see a hell of a lot more games being introduced in the new year.
Yeah, actually, you were doing something on the blog about slots, right? About the Christmas slots.
I've been doing
slots, I should call it.
So. Well, when this airs, it'll be after Christmas.
So
the 12 days of Slotsmas has ended.
I wonder how long they're going to keep the holiday slots on the online casinos.
Oh, they're on year-round. They're on year-round.
Really? Yeah. I can play a Christmas slot in the summertime? Really?
The Thanksgiving games are still up there. The Halloween games are still up
really?
There.
Okay.
The St. Patrick's days.
I see. I thought they were for a limited time.
Oh, no.
Okay. All right.
What
I'll
they do for what the casinos do for a limited time, the online casinos anyway, what they do is they create a special heading on their menu bar that says holiday theme. It has a holiday theme name on it.
See, I'm lazy. When say we just got done with Christmas and they had all their Christmas slots, when I log into the online casino, they're all up there at the top. So, you know, I don't have to go searching around. They're the first slot machines that I see
online.
The
most recently played, yeah.
So, well, not recently played. They're just there on the homepage because they're holiday slots.
Oh, you mean
slots.
The featured games.
Yeah, they're the featured games. So I don't have to go searching around for them. I just assume when they're taken off, they're kind of taken off the site, but I guess not.
No,
so, okay.
they're year-round. So.
So if you enjoy a holiday slot, it's probably still on the site. Okay, that's
good
to know. That's a good tip.
If Santa and his elves are paying out during Christmas, they may still pay out after Christmas.
So if I want to play a Halloween-themed game,
you
I can
play
still
them
play.
Now.
Wow, okay.
Matter of fact, one of the best ones still out there is Sleepy Hollow.
All right, well, I'll check that out. I didn't know that.
Yes.
So
back to Beating the House, we have... Starting off, we're going out to Vegas.
All right.
We haven't done the Venetian too often.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to be talking about what better way to break in a new high-limit gaming lounge than to give out $1 million.
Wow, okay.
They didn't give it out. Someone won it. Let me rephrase that. Giving it out is probably the worst way to do that.
So they just opened up the lounge recently.
It's a recently opened high-limit gaming lounge at the Venetian on the Palazzo Casino floor.
Oh, okay.
We have Scott Richter playing Dragon Link, and the reason I'm giving his last name out will become apparent in a second.
All right.
Scott Richter was playing Dragon Link, game by Aristocrat Gaming. He was doing $250 a bet.
Oh, okay.
Yes. And he won the grand jackpot of $1,081,106.
Wow. That's a good investment.
Yes.
You know, I that's a little out of my betting range for slot machines, but good for him.
Well, this is a great investment for Scott because he's also what's known as a gaming and slot influencer.
Oh, wow. I can't wait for that video, huh?
And his nickname, oddly enough, is the Big Jackpot.
Wow, that's nice.
So we should be seeing the video for this on his channel at some point. So
wow.
Please, if you want, take a look at the Big Jackpot. I've never seen his channel myself.
Okay.
But congratulations to Scott. That's great work.
I love his nickname. You should trademark that or something. You know.
Well, we're going to be leaving Nevada. We're going up to California. We're going to Sacramento County. We've got Sky River Casino giving out two $500,000 jackpots this week.
Two, huh?
Two.
All right.
We have a first-time visitor from San Joaquin County going to the casino, Sky River, which is in Elk Grove, California, at Sacramento County. Won the Progressive Jackpot playing Ultimate Texas Hold'em. Mm-hmm. That person hit for $538,993. We have a returning guest a day or so after that, winning $534,121 playing face-up Pai Gow poker.
Wow.
Another Pai Gow poker variant, the face-up Pai Gow poker.
I guess there was a side bet involved. There's always a side bet
involved. No word on what he wanted on. But, again, it's just face-up. It's not Pai Gow poker. It's just face-up Pai Gow poker.
Okay. All right.
So there had to have been a Progressive involved with some of these, too.
I would think so.
Well, the Progressive jackpot on Ultimate Texas Hold'em. I wonder if they have the linked games.
I don't know how they do it in California.
I don't know how Sky River does it. Mm-hmm. Everyone does it differently, but Sky River may have a linked jackpot.
Yeah, if anyone knows, give us an email.
Exactly. info@turnpikesportsradio.com. Send it over to us. We're going to go from California. Now we're going to Louisiana. We're going to the Delta Downs Racetrack Casino Hotel.
Oh, okay.
Now, the Delta Downs Racetrack Casino is also home to a 3/4 mile horse track.
I got the racetrack part of it. I kind of figured that
15,000 square feet of gaming space, 1,500 gaming machines. And like I said, it's
open. Wow, that's pretty good
it's
size.
It's a
you know?
3/4 mile horse track race. It's open 24 hours every day. One of the few in that area that are open 24 hours, racinos
that's
anyway.
Good to know.
Yes. We have a lucky guest from Texas in Louisiana. Mark is a Boyd's Rewards member.
Okay.
Boyd is the owner of Delta Downs, by the way, since we're using a Boyd Rewards member here.
Boyd Gaming.
Yep. He was, and according to the press release, full of holiday cheer. He was playing Locket Link Huff and Puff game. Now, we talked about Huff and
Puff on the
Jersey Jackpot.
There was
rundown.
Huff and Puff, and then there's something called Huff and More Puff. Is that right?
This is Huff and Puff, the original game.
Oh, the original.
Yes.
Classic.
He was playing the 10-cent machine.
Okay.
No word on what the actual size of the bet was, but they said it was the 10-cent machine.
Okay.
He won $135,020.66.
Wow. Nice.
Yes. And actually, they seem to pay out an awful lot to Texas visitors because not too long ago, back in November, another Texan was visiting the casino and won $664,000 playing Aristocrats Buffalo Grand.
You know, we're saying Texans. It might not be that far away, depending on where in Texas are they from. I mean, if they're on the eastern side of Texas, probably not a long commute to Delta Downs.
I'm just pointing out the fact that with Texas still fighting casino expansion, this money could be going into Texas, not to Louisiana.
Sure.
But we have Delta Downs benefiting from that. That $664,000 was won on a $3.75 bet.
Nice.
No word on what Mark bet, like I said. Got a couple lottery stories this week. A couple interesting ones. We've got the California Lottery announced that a sky cap from the San Francisco airport was on his lunch break, and he bought his usual $30 set for life game.
Okay.
Now, he's been doing
this. Was this in the airport? Was this a store in the airport? Or
he bought it at the, and now let me get it for you here. He bought it at the local liquor store off the grounds of the airport. He was on his lunch break.
Oh, okay.
He's a skycap, which is a porter at the airport.
Sure.
He played the $30 set for life game. He's been playing this. This is habit for him.
Good.
He goes on his lunch break. He buys the ticket. This time, a little different result. He won $20 million.
Wow. Yes. So he's set for life.
He's set for life.
There you go. Set for life. The name of the game and what you are now.
Exactly. So, he didn't even think about winning it. He said he was doing this out of habit. He does it. He gets his lunch. He gets whatever else he gets at the liquor store.
Good for him.
And he buys the ticket. So he had actually won $1,000 previously.
Nice.
Now he's a $20 million.
Yeah, yeah,
and nice. The liquor store gets $100,000.
That's even great for the liquor store.
Keeps the liquor store going.
Sure.
Going out to Colorado now. We have the Colorado Lottery. Actually, we have Lotto.com talking about their game, Monopoly 500 times scratch ticket through the Colorado Lottery. Kind of confusing, I know.
Well, I'm just curious. I know there are slot machines and other games, and I wonder how many games there are with the title Monopoly. I mean, it seems like every time we're talking about a game, it's called Monopoly.
We always have a Monopoly game.
It's something Monopoly. I know the big slot machines are Monopoly, and so we live in New Jersey. Monopoly is based in Atlantic City, so Monopoly's everywhere.
Now, while this person was in Colorado...
So this was a scratch ticket now?
This is through the Colorado Lottery.
It's
a digital scratch ticket.
Oh.
Basically an instant game.
Okay.
The Colorado Lottery, but they purchased it through Lotto.com.
Okay.
So, winning ticket went to a player from Colorado, active user on the platform, Lotto.com, used it by different tickets, participate in various games, bought the Monopoly 500X game, 500 times game, whatever, however you want to say it. This is only a couple of months after the game was just introduced.
Okay.
This person won $3 million.
Jeez.
Top prize.
So technically that's called a digital scratch game?
Yes, digital scratch.
Okay.
And you want to know how active the lottery commissions are with this?
Okay.
2 minutes after she won, she got a call saying she won.
She got a phone call.
Confirming the win.
Not a text, not an email. She got a phone call.
She got a phone call.
All right.
Phone call from the company only 2 minutes after the draw happened. And the agents on the line confirmed that company representatives were already traveling to her place.
Wow.
To take the physical ticket from her, because it's also a physical ticket, but it's a digital draw.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
And they were going to confirm the win in person as well and take the actual ticket from her.
That's efficiency. Yes.
Well, let me tell you something. It's very interesting seeing how these lottery
games... It's probably overwhelming for the winner. I mean, it's just this flurry of activity. I mean, you're caught up in the win, and you're excited about the win. Then all of a sudden, phone calls and people are coming to your place, huh?
Well, I got to get the clip from Night of the Living Dead. We're coming to get you, Barbara.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's basically what they did. They called up and said they're coming to get the ticket.
We're coming over.
Yes. It's kind of interesting seeing how these games are evolving. You can actually buy a digital draw game in a retail store, as well as going through online.
Yeah.
Which is kind of weird.
I guess so.
I guess they
have all the person's information online when you sign up at Lotto.com. So they have your phone number, they have your address, and they know
where
you are.
If it's through your account through Lotto.com, they got everything.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. So, but, it's kind of interesting that, a physical ticket. I wonder if this was a printed out ticket. It doesn't say if she bought it at a store. She bought it through Lotto.com, but doesn't say where the printout.
I'm shocked they called. I'm shocked they went over within minutes.
I'm shocked they need to go get the physical ticket from her instead of pulling it out of her account.
Well, I think
Yeah, maybe I don't know.
I think they probably do everything. Yeah. I mean,
Well, we'll see. Anyway, right now we're going to go around the world here. We got two non-North American stories. We've got the Chinese lottery. I don't think we've ever done a Chinese lottery story.
Right. Okay.
I wish I had a formal name for this, but all I can say is Chinese lottery. All the articles I've read on this, besides the press releases, did not say anything about Colorado, what the name of the Chinese lottery was.
Okay.
We have, I almost said Colorado.
Yeah, I don't know. Wait, you're talking about Colorado.
Don't listen to me, folks.
Wow.
I'm only just doing the stories here.
Oh, wow.
We have a Chinese man putting all his eggs in the same basket, buying over 50,000 lottery tickets and playing the same number on all of them.
Wow.
50,000 lottery tickets.
Oh, my God. What an investment.
I would
think it would. I don't know what the price of this lottery is, but 50,000 lottery tickets is...
He went around all the different stores in the province, the Nanchang province.
Okay.
And bought all the available Happy 8 tickets.
All right.
And then he put the same numbers on all of them.
Okay.
40, 41, 40, 41, 42, 44, 63, 64, and 65.
Wow.
Those were the numbers on all 50,000 tickets.
That seems to be a strategy for a lot of people, buying a bunch of lottery tickets with the same numbers on it. So I guess it works. So it might be an interesting strategy.
Here's the interesting part of this. Not a single jackpot in any of this.
Okay.
He won all the second prizes.
Oh, okay. So
the equivalent of $628 on each ticket. Multiply that by 50,000 times.
Wow.
He ended up with around $30 million U.S. dollars.
Wow. Okay.
Didn't win a single top prize. He won the second prize.
So what he won was the accumulation of a second-tier win. So, wow. Okay.
Well, when you buy 50,000 tickets,
good
that
for,
adds up.
Good for him, I guess.
Well, you know what? When you hit,
What made him? I guess that's a good investment.
He is known for doing this, according to all the reports. Well,
it works. Yeah. I guess it works.
He has done this in the past several times.
The thing is, I'm curious to see how many other people do it now. They see it works, so, you know.
Well, he's a bulk.
It's good for the lottery company there or whatever.
Whatever
they call
it
there,
yeah.
I'm sure people are going to be buying lots of tickets now.
Well, hey, you know, it's an interesting strategy. People do it here in the United States, too, where they buy X number of tickets and play the same numbers on that. I've never heard 50,000 either. So.
No.
But we don't know how much the tickets were either.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, they could be like 10-cent tickets in U.S. dollars.
I don't know.
Going to leave China, and we're going to Australia now.
All right.
And this is the Australian lottery called The Lot.
The Lot.
L-O-T-T.
The Lot.
Yes.
Okay.
And what better way to open a brand new bar in Australia than to give out $1 million jackpot?
Wow. Okay. So what? I guess, you know, it sounds like Massachusetts, where bars and restaurants are allowed to do lottery tickets and keno and things like that. Okay.
Exactly.
So Australia has... You know, you could buy your ticket in whatever. Okay. In the restaurant or a bar or whatever the hell this is.
A pub. They call it a club, but it's actually a pub. It's
okay.
A tavern.
Whatever.
Twin Towers Juniors. Twin Towns Juniors, which is over in New South Wales.
All right.
Also, the resident is a local, too.
Good.
So he's from...
It's always good when locals win.
He's from a town called Tweedheads.
Tweedheads. Okay.
T-W-E-E-D.
All right.
It's... It's actually a coastal town, the mouth of the Tweed River.
Oh,
so
okay.
Tweedheads.
The head of the Tweed River.
Exactly.
So, which makes sense.
So he was there at the opening day of this club. I'll call it what they're called.
They call
the
it
club.
A pub.
He was eating lunch.
All right.
Playing keno.
Keno. Okay, there you go.
Matter of fact, he was playing keno classic 10 spot,
whatever
which is what that game is
okay.
for the Australian okay. lottery. First day the club was open, he's sitting around eating his lunch. He hears everybody cheering in the pub. Mm-hmm. He didn't know what was going on. He looked up. Somebody hit $1,779,864 on the Keno Classic 10 spot game.
Wow.
He looked up and said, "I just wish it was me."
Wow.
Went home.
And it was him.
Looked at his ticket.
Okay.
It was him. He had no idea he was sitting there for the entire time he was eating lunch that he had won the $1.7 million.
You know, that kind of thing probably worked out for him, because if he jumped up and said, "Hey, I got the ticket," or something like that, would have been a whole kind of situation there, I would think. I don't know, but it actually worked out well. He left and he found out alone, and so that was probably worked out the best for him. Good for him.
Normally you hear stories of people sitting there knowing they won and, you know, didn't say anything because they didn't want to cause a stir. This guy didn't even think he
didn't
won.
Even,
he was like, "I wish I had won something like that." So kind of interesting story for that one. But
yeah,
congratulations to Twin Towns Juniors on your opening day giving out $1.7 million.
See, that's good for the bar, too, because what publicity they're
getting
around the country and around the world, you know?
That's it for this week's Beat the House. Congratulations to all the winners we talked about in the show here, as well as all the winners out there that we didn't talk about. There's plenty more. We just do $100,000 or more on this show, but there are plenty of winners out there. So congratulations, everybody. And we'll see you next week.
Well, that'll do for us this week. We'll see you next time with House of Cards.